Welcome to Computational Finance and its Object-Oriented Implementation. And we are in the middle of discussing automatic differentiation, algorithmic differentiation. And we arrived at the point where we introduced the algorithm, which was surprisingly short. It was based on a little bit of notation. Yeah, so our computer program is a sequence of functions fm. The only thing we need is the partial derivative of this function fm with respect to its arguments. So we also need what are the arguments of this function. That means we need to know the index of the previous result that enters into this function. All results are enumerated by something which in the code we call ID. Yeah, so this is the ID of this node. Yeah, so this is a kind of an ID. That was the algorithm. The proof was quite simple. Once we have introduced a kind of notation, namely the notation what is meant by dy with respect to dxm. So it's the partial derivative of a function that considers all previous values up to xm as independents, and then differentiates the final results with respect to all these independents. And at the core of our theorem is a very simple update rule that is just a chain rule applied to the movement from one node to the next node, so the dependency of a node of its arguments. Yeah, so that here was the main part, some kind of update rule. And that was clearly the chain rule, representing a sum because we initialize all the values here to zero. So this is just a summation that is performed there. And the nice thing of this version, writing the algorithm in this version, is that the loops, so for all functions and then for all arguments of the functions, so the loop is quite natural, because it just means we go backwards through all functions. So this means we just sort everything with respect to the ID. And then we just go through the argument list, which we can store at the moment the function is evaluated. So that was a very nice formulation of the algorithm. So the other alternative formulation where we look at which for a given argument, which function uses the argument, is a little bit more complicated to implement, so not so nice. Okay, so, and then the implementation of this algorithm, and that was where we ended in the last session, looks like this. So let me shortly go through this again. So it's only 10 lines. Apart from the fact that we still have to implement the update rule. So our update rule is here the propagate derivatives to arguments. So this is our update rule. So the update rule is offloaded to another function, which we will take a look at in a few minutes. But apart from this update rule, which is just the chain rule. So you see it here again. Yeah, our update rule. This algorithm is very short and it's just the propagation through all the functions backward. Yeah. So you remember that in here, our algorithm, there were actually two loops for all functions, for all arguments. The loop for all functions is here. Yeah, it is this while loop. So this here is looping backward through all functions. or operators, yeah. So functions fm. So this is our loop here, looping backwards through all functions. That we loop backward is implemented in the following way. We store our nodes in a set. So this is here the set nodes to process. We store the nodes in this set. So the complete tree will be in this set. And this set is ordered. So here we have to make the remark, this is an ordered set. Okay, and the ordering is given by this function here. So the ordering is just given by comparing the IDs. Yeah, so the ordering is by ID. And we are taking the last value. So this is here backward. So the reason that we go backward is here that we take the last value is taken from the set and processed. So, and this poll last also removes the node. Removes the node we are working on. And here we add the arguments. To our set. So actually the set does not contain the whole tree, the whole operator tree. It is that we add the nodes one after the other, but we also remove them. Yeah? So this is just the bookkeeping, what are the nodes we have to work on. And you also see that since derivatives only propagate along arguments, we only add the arguments here to this set, nodes to process. So we only add the relevant nodes. So in case that there is some unused calculation in your program, which doesn't enter into the derivative of the output, which you're looking at, this one is not added to the set because it is not an argument. And so it's not calculated. So actually this implementation is more efficient than the algorithm that we had here on the previous slide. Okay, so what else do we have? So this is how we loop through this. So we have to initialize it, and we of course initialize it that the first node we look at is the root node, so it's the output node. So the output node is initialized here to is here added to this as a first and single element. So at this point, where the orange arrow is pointing, at this point, this set contains only one node, namely the output node. And then he's taking the output node, he's calculating the derivatives, propagate the derivatives to the arguments, and then he adds the arguments as a reminder that he has to work on the arguments. And he works on the arguments in the order of decreasing ID. So I will come to the ordering in a few minutes. Okay, so where do we store the derivatives? We store the derivatives in a set. So this is here the set where we store the derivatives. Or actually it's a map, yeah. It's a mapping that maps the node, which is in our implementation value differentiable. Yeah. So that is the object we store. And then also stores the value of the derivative. Yeah. So this is a mapping from node x to the derivative dy by dx. Yeah. So, and the update of this set is performed in this function, which we will take a look next. Yeah? So the only thing we have to do here is to initialize the first value, which is dy by dy. So this is the initialization of this set. Okay, so yeah, that's more or less it. Yeah, did I forget something? Yeah, no. So, of course, here you see if a node has no arguments, we don't need to continue. Yeah, so this is then the end of this part of the tree. Yeah, and at a certain point, the tree will be empty. Yeah, so there is nothing more to do. Yeah, the remainder of the tree will be empty, and then we can return this set. So what we are left with to discuss is here the function that performs this update rule. Yeah, so see next slide. For this function. Yeah. Okay, so and we already checked that this has only 10 lines and the next function has approximately one line per operator and argument because we need to perform here this update rule for every operator. So every operator has a different partial derivative and then for every argument. Okay, so that is here our update rule again. So just the chain rule. And here we have the implementation of this function that propagates the derivative to the arguments. So what we get as arguments here is the derivatives. So this is here our little map. Yeah? So this is here the this map enters as an argument here. So we recover this argument here, the derivatives, this map. And this is the map which will be updated by this function. Yeah. So one has to be careful that this function is not called concurrently. Yeah. So, but our algorithm is currently considered only running in a single thread. Yeah. So for those who are interested in this detail, yeah, we are modifying this map. So, and what do we need? We need the current node. So where are we now? So this is actually here the M of this function. And we need the list of all arguments. So this is here the list of all arguments where the derivatives are propagated. So this is here the list of all arguments. So this is what we need for our update rule. Okay, and then you see that we have here something like the new derivative. Yeah, so this is D of the first argument. Yeah. So this here is the di0. It's the argument starts with 1. Okay. di1 superscript m. Yeah. So the derivative of the first argument is set 2. Yeah. So this here is the put is set 2. So is equal. The derivative of this argument again, so di1 superscript m. So this is what you see here. Yeah. So we ask what is the value which you currently have, and then you see that here I'm using some kind of get or default with a 0. So actually this is because I didn't initialize the tree. If the derivative dij has never been touched before, I have to initialize my summation to 0. So this here initialized to 0 is what you have in our theorem here. Yeah. So it's this initialization. Okay, so which you recover, which you recover here in this get or default. Yeah, so this is the initialization. So we set this, and then it goes on with plus the derivative of the current node. So the current node is get the derivative of the current node, so dm. So you see there's the current node again here. Partial derivative dfm with respect to the argument dx1. Yeah, so here's dx1. So that is our partial derivative here, which is this one. Okay, and let's just check that we did it correctly. Yeah, if you have z is equal to x plus y, then you have dz by dx is equal to 1, and dz by dy is equal to 1. Yeah, so these two ones here are the ones you see here. Okay, and for subtraction, if the operator is x minus y, the derivative is plus 1, and here's a minus, minus 1. If the function is x times y, the derivative with respect to x is y. So you see here, I'm just asking the first argument and then its value. This is y. And the derivative with respect to y is just x. So you see here, it's plus this. That was the second argument. Huh? So the list is enumerated starting with 0. The second argument and then its value. So this is the y. And here's the first argument. And then its value, this is the x. Yeah? So dz by dy is x. Okay, and you see this is all the partial derivatives. And you see here I did a small mistake. I forgot the implementation of the division. Yeah? So let's fix this together. And if I'm while I'm doing this, yeah, so fixing this together, it's maybe also a good time here to introduce unit testing. Yeah, so you can write small program that perform tests. And here I have a test, yeah, that calculates some function and then calculates the derivative and then performs a comparison of this derivative with respect to an analytic one. And maybe I like to have a similar test for each operator. Yeah, so we should the operator, and let's write a small test for the division operator with respect to the first argument, for example. So maybe we can have a small tutorial session on unit testing. So I'm using here a framework, JUnit, but actually it's just like a small main method, like a small program. And in addition, you have some test criteria, assert equals, which you can add, and he will then check if this test criteria is met. So we will see this while we are doing this. So let's define some values. So let's define here an x, or let's call it x zero, as value double differentiable with the value of 6. So this is our leaf node. And then I define x1 as, so what do we do? X divided by y. So let's take a 2 here. So we have 6 divided by 2. Yeah, so let's calculate y is 6, so x 0 divided by 2. Okay. That should be 3, yeah. And now calculate the differential. So this is the derivative algorithmic. So this should be x0, y differentiated. Ah, so I need a cast here. So let's perform a cast. So this is y differentiated with respect to why doesn't he like me? With respect to x0, so the first argument. Help me, what did I wrong? Ah, there's a packet missing. Ah, stupid. Okay. So then we have the algorithmic differentiation. And what is the analytic differentiation? So the derivative analytic . So if you differentiate x divided by y with respect to the first argument, it's 1 divided by x. So this should be 1 divided by 2. Okay, so and now we can, maybe we can print the 2 if you like, just to see that what's going on here. So I print this one and I print the other one. Okay, and let's add this assert statement. So assert that the derivative analytic is equal to the derivative algorithmic. Yeah. So actually this is an object, so I have to ask for the value with respect to some tolerance, which is maybe the machine precision, because you know that there could be differences in rounding this operation. Okay, so now we have a small test and I can run this test here. Okay, so what's happening? Am I in the right program? Ah, test order. I have to, I forgot one thing. The unit test framework only runs tests that have this annotation. Yeah? So you saw he only runs the first test, but he didn't run the second test. The first test was passing. So you have to add this annotation. And then this framework looks for all functions that have this annotation here, and then calls this function and runs it. Okay. So I get 0.5, 0.5. So it looks as if the code is correct. Yeah. So let's go back. Did I add the code? For division. Oh, yes, the code is already here. So it was missing on my slide, but it was not missing in the program. Let's just remove this here. Okay, so let's remove this and let's run the test again. Okay, so now you see here a red bar. The test is failed. He tells us that he was expecting 0.5, but the result was 0.0. So the test fails and we need to add this code here to make the test work. So let's add the code back and let's do it live. Maybe we make it a little bit more expressive. So what do we need? We need, of course, our two arguments of the functions. So let's consider these to be x and y. So this is x divided by y. Z is equal to x divided by y. So that is the first argument is arguments get me the first argument, and from that I would like to have the floating point value, because that I need in my calculation, and the y is the second argument. So in the list of arguments, it is at index one, and from that we need the floating point value. Okay, then our update rule goes as follows. We take the derivative we see for the argument, so that is derivatives get, and if there is no value, we take the default to be zero. So get or default for which argument? So this is for the first argument. So this is for arguments zero. So this is the floating point value of the derivative we see in the first argument, the di. And we add the derivative of the current node. So derivatives get the current node. And then we multiply with the partial derivative dz by dx. Dz by dx would be just 1 divided by y. So we divide by y. So this value, this floating point value, is then put into di again. So I put this value, derivatives, put at the place where we store derivatives for the first argument. So this here, this lengthy thing, is the value that we store there. Okay, so and for the derivative of the second argument, we put the derivative for the second argument to be updated by get the derivative of the second argument plus dm multiplied with the partial derivative dz by dy. And dz by dy is multiplied with x divided by y squared. So let's say y times y. And then with a minus, because the derivative is minus x divided by y squared. So we have a minus here. Okay, so that should be it. So we used now 4 lines instead of 2 lines, because I was fetching these guys here before. Okay, so and let's run the test again. Okay, and now the test is green. Okay, and maybe a small remark that this will be also explained or discussed in the exercises. It's important that we store here this result, and then that we get here the derivative with respect to the first argument, because it can be that the two nodes are the same. It can be that somebody calculates x divided by x, and then it's important to apply the update rule iteratively. So that was here the completion of this program. So code session, we already had a code session. We already went through the code in the last session. Also, so that was done, and I like to discuss a little bit more issues with the code design. So this is more implementation focus now for the next 10 or 20 minutes, but I believe it's really important, and the aspects we are touching here are maybe also important for other applications, not only algorithmic differentiation or mathematical finance. So the first thing is that if you write improper code, then this may result in a broken operator tree. So operator tree is our picture here, that this one depends on this one, and this one has 2 arguments, and so on. Okay. And you know that the derivatives travel along this line, and it may happen that maybe some reference here is missing, or somehow the tree is inconsistent. Yeah. So this may break the operator tree if you write improper code. And I would like to give you two examples. And I also like to give you some advice how you can avoid this. And avoid also means that if you write code in a team, so you implement the algorithmic differentiation framework and another one uses it, that you somehow write your code such that the other guy, yeah, your colleague, isn't even allowed to do the evil stuff. Yeah? So how can we disallow programming aspects that destroy the calculation? Because if the calculation or if the tree is destroyed, we will get a wrong derivative. Yeah, and such a bug is hard to find because you just get a wrong value, but you don't get any warning message that the value is wrong. Yeah, and if you have a complicated calculation, maybe it's hard to know that something like this is happening. For example, here in our code. So, for example, here it's maybe hard to find that this derivative with div is not there. If you have a big calculation where div is just one operator of out of many. Yeah. Okay. So the first example is related to our implementation. And if we go back and have a look at how the algorithmic differentiation is implemented here, then you see when somebody performs an operation like multiplication or squared, all we do is we perform the calculation and then we just remember what operator was used and what were the arguments. And we do this by just calling the constructor with these two things. Of course, if you would call this constructor here and you would here add a different operator, the whole calculation would work. Yeah. But the derivative, which we are calculating here, doesn't correspond. Yeah. Or let's take square root, yeah, because it is a function of one argument. So it doesn't correspond to the value that has been calculated. So actually, a code like this would work in the calculation, but give you a wrong derivative because the operation which you remember is inconsistent with the way the value was calculated. And to avoid this, we make the constructor private. So it's not allowed for somebody else, except for our implementation, to call this constructor. So in our code, the tree is built, yeah, by calling this constructor here and remembering the operator that was used. And there is a certain constraint in the program. So this has to be consistent. Okay, and we disallow the creation of nodes from outside by making this constructor here private. Okay, so it's not possible to call this constructor from outside. The only construction of a node that can be performed from outside is that of leaf nodes. Only leaf nodes can be created. And remember, what is the property of a leaf node? A leaf node has no arguments. So a leaf node has no arguments. So this means our algorithm, yeah. So if we go back here, our algorithm will not continue if the node has no arguments. If the arguments are null, we don't continue. So the propagation of the derivative stops. Okay, so the leaf nodes have no argument. So that's now a technique that actually prevents creating an inconsistent tree, which would get a wrong derivative. So a next example, which is a bit more tricky, is that extraction of the floating point values allows to break the tree. And now you think, okay, but it must be possible to extract the value, otherwise I cannot get the result. Yeah. So this function as floating point, which we provide, is evil. It can allow to break the tree. And to describe this, consider the example of a function f of x0 and x2, which calculates our final result, the y, and our input nodes are x0 and x1. And x1 is used in the calculation of x2. So the function I'm looking here is y is f of x0 and g of x0 and x1. Okay, clearly, if you differentiate this function with respect to x0, it's the differential of f with respect to its first argument plus f with respect to its second argument multiplied with g with respect to its first argument. It's just a chain rule. And here I have a small calculation of this. Yeah. So we have the two arguments, x0 and x1. So, and I use this now with the example x is f is x0 minus x2 and g is x0 multiplied. So maybe I have a dot here multiplied with x0. Okay, so this here is my function g, and this here is my function f, and then I return the value. And the operator tree of this looks like this. Yeah. So the final value f is a function of two arguments, x0 and x2. And x2 is a function of x0 and x1. So this is how the tree looks like. Okay. So I have implemented this example here. Yeah. So I create two values, x0 and x1. I perform the calculation. Y is a function of x0 and x1. And then I ask for the derivative of y with respect to x0, and I print this. So I use here the function perform calculation. So this is my implementation of the function. But here now I have the same thing, where I perform the calculation with a function that is somewhat broken. And I calculate the derivative of this value that was calculated with the broken function, and then also print this. And now let's take a look at the implementation of these two functions. Here they are. This is what you saw just on the slide. G is x0 times x1. F is x0 minus x2, so minus g. And this is our value. And now let's perform the same calculation in a slightly different way. So I calculate x2 by performing f x0 with x1. And now I'm asking, okay, let's have a look at the value that we have calculated. So we extract the value x2 as a floating point number. So we extract this value. No. And then we create a new leaf node that has exactly the same value. And then we subtract from x0 this copy of x2. Actually, this algorithm gives us the same value, but it breaks the operator tree. It gives us a different derivative. Let's look back at the slide. So this here is the broken code. Yeah. So we extract here the we extract here the value. So what is going on here? So y is a function of let's go here, x0 and x2. But x2 is initialized to a value, say this is x2 copy, to a value we have calculated from, so maybe I make the tree a little bit longer. So we have calculated from x0 and x1. So this here is our x2. And then we are copying this value to there. So it has the same value, but the operator tree is broken. And this one is just a function of two leaf nodes. So if you are looking for the derivative of this value, with respect to the arguments, he will propagate the derivative here and here, but he will not continue to x1. And actually, this road here is missing, is broken. Yeah? So actually, the error is quite subtle. So you see a value, but you see a wrong value because a certain part of the derivative is missing. And that just happens because we have extracted a value and reinitialized a node with that value. So the dependency was lost. Well, maybe you think, okay, this is a trivial example, and it's clear that if somebody does something like this, he's doing a mistake. But this is just an obvious example here because it is so small. Think, for example, the case that you like to calculate the variance of a random variable. And before that, you have calculated the expectation. So maybe it's very obvious to say, okay, the variance is just x minus expectation squared. And from that, I take the expectation. Then it is very tempting to use in x minus expectation, the floating point value of the expectation, and not the object. Yeah. So sometimes it can be quite tempting to do this mistake. Maybe we just run this program here with the broken and the correct implementation. So this program is called broken. And you see that it's calculating the same value for both trees. So actually, what are we doing here? It is this one multiplied with this one, and then we subtract. Yeah. So this is 1 minus 2 gives us a minus 1. And the derivative with respect to x0 is 1 minus x1. So it's actually 1 minus 2. The correct derivative is minus 1. This one gives us the correct derivatives. But this one just gives us one, which is the derivative with respect to the first argument, x0. And this one is missing. Yeah. So you see, just the part was missing. And it's not so obvious that this here is a wrong value. It's a value. Yeah. So if there is a zero, maybe you would be suspicious. But if some value is there, maybe you are not so, so suspicious that this has gone one. Okay, so I also mentioned that I want to show you how you can avoid this. And you see that here in our code, these functions operate on value, yeah? On our interface. So actually I can forbid that he does this by just removing this method here from the interface. Let's do this. Let's remove this method from the interface. So this allow that he calls this method. So now you would say, okay, this is a problem because we can now perform calculations, but I can never get the result, yeah, because I can never look at what is the result of the calculation. So of course now he has certain complaints here. Here we need this value, yeah, in our implementation. Yeah. So how can we fix this? Yeah, we just create another interface that has this function. So I create a new interface. Let's call this value convertible to floating point. Yeah. Or we can just call it convertible to floating point. So this is my new interface. And this interface, convertible to floating point, is saying that you are allowed to use this function. Okay, and then here in our implementation, we say, okay, this implements value. That means you are allowed to perform the calculations. And it also implements the other implements convertible to floating point. So this implementation is convertible to floating point and also also allows the for differentiable. I didn't do it. No, I don't care. So let's also remove it here. It's already extending value. So that's okay. So so now I have split the availability of the methods to two different interfaces. Yeah, and so you see now here, this code is just fine, but this code here complains because the argument here is just value, and he tells me you are not allowed to use this method. Of course, the user can still do it by doing a cast. Yeah, so he can do a cast here, cast this to this interface. Yeah, and then he can maybe extract this value. So I have to import it, I assume. Cannot be resolved. I didn't save it or what? Let's see. What is he complaining? Oh yeah, I have to import it. Okay. So now the program is fixed. Yeah. Fixed but broken. So the user can still do it by doing a cast, but now he has to explicitly do the mistake. Yeah. Or it's more explicitly that he has to do this mistake. So that is a way to forbid this. So, and now if you implement functions with respect to this value, like this, then he will complain. Yeah. So, and of course, whenever you have to use the floating point value, now you have to perform such a cast here. Yeah. So, but this is now a willingly performed cast. So you are aware of what you are doing. So I will fix the program for you later, yeah, and check it in. And we will use then this convertible to floating point interface and put this dangerous method in this interface. And we can be sure that now, whenever somebody uses this interface here, our algorithmic differentiation tree will not be broken. Okay, so that was reducing the risk of breaking the operator tree. Yeah, so a way of healing this is moving the evil method as floating point from the interface. Next thing which I like to shortly mention is if we go back to our program, I was stressing that it is important that we propagate here in the right ordering. And I just want to illustrate this to you. So now I'm a bit here in trouble, yeah, because my program has all these red flags. Yeah, so let me add this interface here so that the program works. Yeah, let's check if everything works here by running our old program. Yeah, it looks good. Okay, so this here is our algorithmic differentiation algorithm. Yeah, so this amazingly short thing. And I mentioned that it's important to loop through all the nodes backward. So why is it important to loop through all the nodes backward? So let's make another drawing. Yeah. So if you have this one depends on that one, on that one, on that one. So maybe the tree like this, yeah? So then if we now go that this one here propagates the derivative down to here, and this one propagates the derivative down to here, and this one propagates down to here. So then it's clear that the ID of that one here, let me see, the ID of that one here is smaller than the ID of that one, yeah? So this ID is larger than that one. So it means that I'm doing this one here first, yeah? And propagate the derivative from that one to there, to there. Yeah? Let's assume that this one here also depends on that one. Yeah. So now I have a nice example. Yeah. So and this means that at this point we have added these two guys here to the tree, and it's important now that I execute the one with the larger ID first, because if I would now work on the one with the smaller ID, I would start propagating his derivative down here and here, yeah, before I have propagated the correct derivative from the node, purple node with the larger ID to the purple node with the smaller ID. Yeah. So that would create a wrong order in propagating the derivative, and that would result that we have wrong partial derivatives. So it's important to do this in the right order. And I just want to show you this here by let's just print the nodes we are working on. So here, this is the place where we pull the node which we work on, and we can print here this ID of the node. And we can run some program. So what program should we run? Maybe we run our old program that calculates the derivative of the hypotenuse. Yeah? So let's run this program now and have a look at what is the order of IDs. So he works at the node 6, which is here the result. Then he goes to the node 5, which is the argument of the square root. Then he goes to the node 4, which is the x square, and the node 3, which is the y square, yeah, or the other way around, because for the add function, it's not so important. And then he goes to the x square, to the x and the y. Yeah, so z is square root of x square and y square. Yeah, you see there is a node missing. The number 2 is missing. Okay, so and that was the remark that the algorithm is even more efficient. He only touches those nodes that are relevant. Okay, which guy is number 2? Yeah? So you see in our program, a is 0, b is 1. And the epsilon, which we used in the finite difference, is the node number 2. So this node is not relevant. And then we are performing the calculation a squared, which will result in node 3, b squared, which will result in the node 4, plus, which will result in the node 5, and take the square root, which will result in the node 6. And you see that he is performing it in the right order, because 6 has the argument 5, 5 has the argument 3 and 4. From 3 and 4, take the highest one. So I take 4. 4 has the argument 1. So then, but take 3, because it is the highest one. 3 has the argument 0. Then take 1, and then take 0. So he's always adding the arguments, and he's going in the right order. That he's going in the right order is actually in our algorithm prescribed by the ordering we have here. So this is O1 compared to O2, in this tree set. And this compare to operator, actually, if you look here, returns an integer. And it returns an integer. It returns 0 if the 2 are equal. It returns a value that is less than 0 if one is before the other. And it returns a number that is larger than 0 if the one is after the other. Yeah. So this is the ordering function here, the compare to function we have to enter here. And we are taking from this natural ordering of numbers the last one. So I can modify this ordering by placing a minus here, yeah, because then he's just flipping the ordering. And let's run the program again. So you see our partial derivative here is 0.28, and that was the ordering. And now I run the program again, and I have broken here the ordering. Yeah, and you see that he is using here now a different ordering. So the argument of 5 was 3 and 4. And he's taking the 3, and the argument of 3 is taking was 0, so he's adding the 0, then he's taking the 0, and so he's going actually in the wrong ordering. Then he's taking the 4, and the argument of 4 was 1. In this special example here, the derivative is correct, and the reason why the derivative is correct is that the operators we used were actually commutative, yeah, x times x a squared plus b squared is commutative. It did not harm us here that we have the wrong ordering. But I have another test here. Yeah, so here in our unit test, I have a test which is similar to the tree which I have just drawn, and this test is sensitive to the ordering. Yeah, so x is the multiple, so it's a function of x, which I first, so should we go through this? Okay, let's go through this. So I multiply x with 2, yeah, which gives us x1. Then I multiply x with 4, and then I perform the sum here, okay? So, and this is the result. So let's run this test. So that was here the test program. And you see the ordering in this program is now broken. Yeah. Okay. So we are calculating the wrong derivative. Yeah, maybe I upload this program and you can check it a little bit, or you can play around with this. So, but to save a little bit of time, let's go on. So let's fix this. Yeah, run our unit test to check that everything is okay again. And yeah, so the ordering is now okay. So that was a small remark on the ordering. And a last remark, if you have a program that runs in multiple threads, yeah, so it runs parallel on multiple cores, but uses your implementation of value, so which creates the nodes, yeah, that is perfectly okay, as long as in your program you use some thread-safe implementation of the guy that generates the IDs. Which we actually did. Yeah, so this is maybe a little bit more nerdy aspect for the guys who like programming. So if you consider concurrently running with this implementation, it's actually perfectly okay as long as you count the IDs in an atomic way. So it's not possible that two guys get the same ID by just running very fast this code. Okay, so that was just this last remark. Yeah, that was my session on algorithmic differentiation. And we will then move to a new topic. So we have 30 minutes left, yeah. So we can have a nice introduction into this topic, and then we have a more deeper look next time. Okay, so now in our lecture, I will start with stochastic automatic differentiation, and that sounds fancy, but at first it's not fancy at all. Yeah, it's very, very trivial, but it will become more fancy as we move on. And there's one aspect that I did actually not stress in the previous discussion. Yeah, for example, here on our notation. Actually, I never mentioned what are x0 and x1 and xn minus 1 and y, and what is f. Yeah? So only when I had this slide on the efficiency and the performance of the algorithm, I made the small remark that this is in Rn, yeah, something like this, so it is a real number. But maybe it was a mistake to mention this, because actually everything we did until here could be on any space, yeah, or on more general spaces, yeah, as long as you have a certain kind of chain rule. Yeah, the only thing we need was a differential operator and a chain rule, so it can be generalized. And the generalization, which I would like to do now in this stochastic automatic differentiation, is just to say that xm, so the values, so our arguments, and y, so our outputs, are random variables. So this is now the important thing here. So they are random variables. This means that fm is a mapping that maps random variables to random variables, so which I call a stochastic operator. And those who have seen the numerical methods already know that we have implemented everything in terms of an object, and this object is a random variable. So now in a Monte Carlo simulation, a random variable is just a vector of samples. Yeah. So x of omega 0, x of omega 1, x of omega 2, it's just a vector. So to some extent, this step just means for a Monte Carlo simulation, let's have a look at everything being vectorized. Yeah? So all equations are now vector equations. A vector is mapped on a vector. And that is maybe a little bit trivial view. It is correct to some extent. And well, if you go back through the slides, you will observe that all formal algorithm and all proofs are still valid if you change the interpretation of the XM and the XY. So actually the change which we are doing here is that is a little bit more than just looking at the object as vectors. Okay, and let's make this as a small remark here. So the algorithmic differentiation or backward algorithmic differentiation, which is called a joint algorithmic differentiation from the previous section, can be applied to Monte Carlo simulations or Euler schemes of Monte Carlo simulations of Euler schemes. So it can be applied to Monte Carlo simulations of Euler schemes of SDEs, yeah, using floating point numbers. Because we just replace the floating point number used in our calculation with our object that performs the tracking of the algorithmic differentiation. So this means that what we actually do is we perform a Monte Carlo simulation. We perform a Monte Carlo simulation of random variables that have been calculated using Euler scheme. Where the random variables inside the Euler scheme used floating point arithmetic. Okay, so we can already use our algorithmic differentiation for our application. Yeah, no problem. By replacing the floating point arithmetic with our algorithmic differentiation floating point arithmetic. Yeah, so we just replace the object of the arithmetic operators. But what I will do now is a little bit different, because I like to commute the numerical methods. I like to actually perform algorithmic differentiation on random variables. And that means that I'm not replacing the placing the algorithmic differentiation inside. I place it a little bit outside. Yeah? So actually I'm performing the algorithmic differentiation of a Monte Carlo simulation of random variables created from an Euler scheme. Uh, Of course, I'm doing this by replacing the implementation of the random variables. So this view is maybe not so 100% correct, but it's a little bit that we view the algorithmic differentiation on a new with a new view where the X, M, and Y are random variables. So let's start and have a look at this. So the formal algorithms for automatic differentiations, they are the same. But if we now reinterpret them in terms of random variables, this allows us to make some improvements. For example, we may improve the requirement to store something in memory. So you remember that when we go backwards with the derivative, it means that we have to remember all the nodes that have been used in the calculation. And in order to calculate in the backward algorithm the derivative, we need also to remember the values of the arguments, yeah? Because we are calculating the derivative at a later point, and we need to remember the values of the arguments. So we need to store the values to calculate the partial derivatives. So that is maybe a big requirement. So consider a Monte Carlo simulation that has 100 million simulation passes, and you have 100 operations that have been performed. For example, you have an Euler scheme that has three operations per time step, and it has approximately 30 time steps, then you have 100 operations performed. So you have 100 million of these nodes, and every so floating point values in this node. Yeah. So you have 100 nodes, and every node has 1 million Monte Carlo sample passes. And so it's a vector. So I have 100 million floating point numbers, which I have to remember. And a floating point number has 8 bytes, so I have 800 million bytes. So this is 800 megabyte. So I need to store almost a gigabyte to calculate the partial derivatives. Well, a gigabyte is not that much. Yeah, it's not out of scope. So, but it's already not negligible. There is some interest in reduce the requirement for the storage. And later, so this will be in the next session, which we have, we will also look at more complicated operators like conditional expectations and indicator functions. Yeah, an indicator function is not differentiable. Yeah, there is a jump. Yeah, at the jump point. If you neglect the jump point and just say the derivative is always zero, the derivative is wrong. But indicator functions occur very often in mathematical finance in Monte Carlo simulations. So what is the algorithmic differentiation applied to an indicator function? And also a conditional expectation is a very common operator in mathematical finance. So what is algorithmic differentiation applied to conditional expectation operator? And now taking this different view that we perform automatic differentiation on random variables, we can actually greatly simplify the handling of these operators, or give proper definitions for operators which are actually on a pass-by-pass basis, not differentiable. So let's start by looking at what it means to perform an algorithmic differentiation of a Monte Carlo simulation. So, well, if Y and X are now random variables, And we have a Monte Carlo simulation. So we have a discrete sample space. So we have Monte Carlo passes omega 1 to omega n. So now there is this little bit abuse of notation in the previous session. N was always the number of leaf nodes in our tree. But actually now we don't need to look at this anymore. So n is now the number of Monte Carlo passes. So this is here our Monte Carlo simulation with a discrete sample space. So actually, this means y and x are vectors, y of omega I and x of omega I. Okay, so I from 1 to n. So what is now dy by dx? Actually, it could happen that any value of the vector y depends on any other value of the vector x. Yeah? So if y, the random variable, is a function of x, then we can have any dependency. Yeah? So let's don't exclude any dependency. And that means that the partial derivative dy by dx is a matrix. Yeah? So how does the output of y, so the value of y on pass omega I, change when the value of x on pass omega j changes? Yeah? So this here is a matrix. So actually this is a bit of a problem, but and we will discuss this problem. So this is a matrix. So the matrix would require, if we store the derivative, the partial derivative, this would require a lot of storage. Well, maybe a remark here at this point. Yeah, when we perform the backward algorithmic differentiation, we multiply each derivative that propagates backward with the partial derivative. But we don't remember the partial derivative. We remember the operator and the arguments and calculate the partial derivative on the fly. Yeah, so we have here this function, this function propagate derivatives to argument, and this function remembers the operator that was used to create this node and the arguments. So actually we don't remember dfm by dxi. We remember what fm was used and what is dxi. And then in this method, calculate the derivative at the update rule. So we could also, this is what would be another alternative in the implementation, calculate this here while we were building the value, so while we were executing each operator, and then just remember this here. Yeah? But now in the application of the stochastic algorithmic differentiation, you see that actually remembering this guy would require much more storage than remembering the function and the arguments. Maybe. So there's already some subtle implementation aspects here. Okay, so that is what we have if we look at the Monte Carlo simulation. Luckily, in most applications in mathematical finance, the operators are pathwise. So what does this mean? So a pathwise operator is that we have a function which operates on the vector element by element. So the value of y on path k is just a function of x of on this path k, yeah, on path omega k. Yeah? So this means that f acts on the vector X Omega I in an element wise manner. Yeah, so for example, in the Black-Scholes model for a European option, you have that you calculate the maximum of S minus K and zero, but this maximum function is applied on every pass. Also an example is the Euler scheme. Yeah? The Euler scheme. Well, the Euler scheme is x at a new point in time, gi plus one. So actually it's x tilde. Yeah. X tilde is the Euler approximation, is the value at the previous point in time of x tilde plus mu at ti evaluated in x tilde of ti. Multiplied with delta t. So you see, this is all operations on random variables. All operations on random variables. Plus sigma ti times delta w. This is the normal distributed increment, the Brownian motion ti. And now, actually, this is evaluated on a pass by pass manner. Okay, so we calculate the value of x tilde ti on pass omega by looking at the previous values on this pass omega. So the Euler scheme is an example for this. The complete Euler scheme is a concatenation of passwise operators. So nice thing is, if we have passwise operator, then this matrix is actually a diagonal matrix. Yeah, because it means that for I not equal j, y of omega I does not depend on x of omega j. Yeah? So we have that all these guys are zero. So this means, to remember this matrix, I can store a vector. Yeah. So we can represent it as a vector. And now the multiplication of the partial derivative, actually it is a matrix multiplication. Previous derivative multiplied with this matrix gives the new derivative. So it is vector equals matrix times vector. But this matrix multiplication, if it is a diagonal matrix, now becomes a vector element-wise multiplication. Yeah? So the concatenation, so the multiplication, the matrix multiplication corresponds to element-wise multiplication. And now we are very efficient. Yeah? So this here is of order n. Yeah? For every Monte Carlo pass, perform this calculation, while that guy here would have a chain rule of order n squared. Yeah, it's a matrix times vector multiplication. So order n squared with respect to calculation time or to performance. Okay, so when we look at random variables or a Monte Carlo simulation, it's important to distinguish, is the operator passwise or is it not passwise? One second. Yeah. So I will later look at non-passwise operators. So we have a few. Yeah. Conditional expectation is an example of a non-passwise operator. Expectation is also non-passwise because it takes information from all passes. But first, let's have another aspect. And we have 3 minutes left, and then we can conclude. And that is still memory requirements. So you saw I had this example that I need approximately 1 gigabyte to store a quite decent Monte Carlo simulation on, of an Euler scheme. And if we look at these objects as random variable, we can massively reduce the requirement of storage by looking a little bit closer. For example, I just said that some operators, for example, all operators in the Euler scheme are diagonal matrix, but even more, some operators have deterministic derivatives. Yeah? So some operators have scalar derivatives. So it's even more can be done by looking a little bit closer to the operator. For example, z is x plus y. The partial derivative of z with respect to x is equal to 1. And 1, in this case, is actually the random variable 1. Yeah, it is 1 on every simulation pass. So the random variable 1. So this is 1 of omega I is equal to 1. So if I make a little bit stupid implementation, I could store a vector of 1 million floating point numbers and all being 1. So instead, I can store just a scalar. So what we do is we store just the scalar. And then we need some method of indicating that the random variable is a constant, is deterministic. This means that when I store this partial derivative or whenever I need to store something, I can just store this one. Alternative to storing the partial derivative is to store the operator and the arguments. But this is even more funny here. If you know that the operator is at, you don't need to store the arguments because the derivative is no longer a function of the arguments. Yeah? The derivative is always constant 1, and it doesn't matter what x was. So you can forget about x. So you don't even need to store x. There's another example. If you have the product here, f is x times y, and if you have that x is, for example, deterministic, then the derivative of z with respect to y is x, so it is also just a deterministic, it's a scalar function. And if you go back to our Euler scheme, you see that actually this situation occurs very often. Yeah, I have here two plus operators, so the partial derivative is a constant, and I also multiply here with a number that is actually deterministic, so it's a scalar. Yeah? So, or if you consider the Euler scheme for the Black-Scholes model, so let me write this as a last example. Then you have that the s at the new value is the s at the previous value plus r times s times delta t plus and so on. And you see that this part here if you differentiate this part with respect to the previous value, which we would do in our tree, then this guy is just r times delta t. Yeah, so r times delta t is just a scalar one, and I can optimize the storage. Finally, let's take a look at how we do this. So we can implement the random variable by a class which uses an optimized storage model for deterministic random variables. And so this is then For example, in this library, it is done here. So we can discuss this in more details later or also in an exercise session. So this here is our representation of a random variable. And you see our random variable is represented here by a vector of floating point numbers, but there is an alternative representation. If this is just a deterministic value, then just use this deterministic value and this vector here will be empty. Yeah, so it is null. So you have a little bit optimized storage model. So I have here an optional way of storing the value. And there is then in every function that implements this, for example, let's take the exponential function. Yeah, I implement two different versions. If it is deterministic, then calculate just the exponential for this single value. If it is not deterministic, then iterate over all values of the vector and apply the exponential value pass by pass. Yeah? And of course, this is this question here, is it deterministic? It's just if this array is empty, then take the other value. So it's possible to optimize the storage required by the algorithmic differentiation. And let's move here. Yeah, so this can be discussed maybe later. I have an example of a calculation which requires a lot of memory. It requires 1.5 gigabytes of memory if you store all random variables in the dump a stupid way. Yeah, it requires this here. If you just store what you need and forget about the deterministic or just store the deterministic values, it is 7.6 megabytes. Yeah, so it's a huge factor that is between these, yeah, factor 200. Okay, so that was it for today. Yeah, we will come back to performing algorithmic differentiation on random variables and stochastic problems in the next session. Thanks.